To understand the origins of Fianna Gael and Fianna Fáil, we must go back to 1905, when a party called Sinn Féin was founded, not to be confused with a different party of the same name around today. It was an Irish nationalist party, but initially it did not garner much support. By 1915, Sinn Féin was in such dire straits financially that it could not afford the rent for its party headquarters. The party had a change in fortunes following the 1916 Rising, a rebellion in Dublin against British rule in Ireland, which many falsely believed had been organised by Sinn Féin. Though the Rising failed, the false belief that Sinn Féin had been behind the Rising led to significant growth in their popularity. Sinn Féin made use of their newfound popularity with the electorate and stormed to victory in the 1918 general election, gaining 73 of 105 seats. They had contested the election on a manifesto of establishing a constituent assembly comprising persons chosen by Irish constituencies as the supreme national authority to speak and act in the name of the Irish people. As a result of this, they saw the election as a mandate to establish the Irish Parliament called Dáil Éireann and declared Irish independence. The Dáil was not recognised by the British government and conflict escalated gradually. It was a brutal guerrilla war in which numerous atrocities occurred. On the 21st of November 1920, a squad organised by Michael Collins assassinated 15 British intelligence agents in the early hours of the morning. As retaliation, British soldiers fired on a crowd attending a football match, killing 14 and wounding over 60 more. Following 2.5 years of war, a ceasefire began on the 11th of July 1921. Delegates of the Irish government, including Michael Collins and Arthur Griffith, travelled to meet with British representatives such as David Lloyd George and Winston Churchill. An immediate issue for the Irish delegation was that none of the hardline Republicans such as Carl Brewer or Austin Stack would go. They considered discussions of terms other than an immediate British withdrawal from Ireland tantamount to treason. From the outset of negotiations, the British made it clear a republic was not on offer. Eventually, an agreement was reached whereby the Irish Free State would be established, but it would remain within the British Commonwealth, and elected officials would be required to pledge an oath of allegiance to the British monarch. Ireland would have a status the same as that of the Dominion of Canada. It was also agreed that should Unionists in the North refuse to join an All-Ireland Parliament, they could opt out. A boundary commission would be implemented to redraw the borders between the predominantly Unionist North East and the rest of the country. The Irish delegation were led to believe that the boundary commission would lead to a border change so drastic that Northern Ireland would become too small an area to remain viable. Reunification would only be a matter of time. Michael Collins later stated that Lloyd George had issued an ultimatum to the delegates: sign the treaty without referring it back to the Dáil or resume fighting immediately. Collins, as Director of Intelligence of the Irish Republican Army, didn't believe that they had the strength to win should fighting resume. As a result, the Irish delegation agreed to sign. Dominion status was not what the Easter Rising and War of Independence had been fought to achieve. As a result, few were happy. This led to an impassioned and bitter debate in the Dáil between those in favour of the treaty and those against. Michael Collins and those in favour of the treaty pointed out that all key political and economic powers would be transferred to the Irish government with the treaty, and although it was not ideal, Collins stated that it gives us freedom. Not the ultimate freedom that all nations aspire and develop to, but the freedom to achieve it. While De Valera and those against the treaty believed that the treaty was a betrayal of the Irish Republic that they had sworn to uphold and belittle the sacrifices of those who had given their lives for it. When a vote on the treaty was held, it passed by 64 votes to 57. As a result, De Valera resigned as president and led all his anti-treaty TDs out of the Dáil, permanently shattering the unity of Sinn Féin. This also led to a split of the Irish Republican Army, with anti-treaty elements within holding an army convention and appointing a 16-man executive to act as their authority, as they refused to obey orders from the provisional government. Then, on the 14th of April 1922, anti-treaty forces led by Rory O'Connor took over the forecourts in Dublin and declared it the headquarters of a rival government. A general election was held in June 1922 as a referendum of sorts on the treaty. The result was clear, with pro-treaty Sinn Féin candidates winning 58 seats, to anti-treaty Sinn Féin's 36. The remaining 34 seats of every other party and independents also supported the treaty. Those opposed to the treaty refused to accept this result. The assassination of Field Marshal Henry Hughes Wilson by IRA men on a street in London, which Winston Churchill assumed had been carried out by anti-treaty soldiers, led to the British government demanding that the Irish Free State Army deal with the anti-treaty garrison in the forecourts, or the British Army would return to do it themselves. This pressure led to the Irish government ordering an assault on the forecourts. After 2 days, the anti-treaty garrison inside surrendered. Though the civil war continued for 10 months, sheer weight of numbers and superior weaponry led to victory for the pro-treaty government. The anti-treaty forces attempted a guerrilla-style campaign which had been effective against the British. However, this time, they didn't have the support of the majority of the population, and the pro-treaty forces were familiar with the landscape. Frank Aiken ordered the remaining anti-treaty forces to dump their arms and wait another day. However, many had already been captured or executed through internments and courts-martial. Though a relatively small-scale affair in comparison to civil wars elsewhere, like in Spain or Nigeria, the 10-month-long conflict saw the deaths of many of Ireland's most capable leaders on both sides, such as Cathal Brua, Michael Collins, Liam Lynch and Arthur Griffith. Realising that the rift in Sinn Féin would be impossible to heal, and needing a political vehicle to contest elections, the pro-treaty faction founded Cumann na Gael. Many former supporters of the Irish Unionist Alliance put their support behind Cumann na Gael, as it was seen as less hostile towards them than the anti-treaty Republicans. The anti-treaty side of the civil war remained in Sinn Féin, where although they contested elections, they were abstentionist. In 1926, De Valera proposed that the party move away from abstentionism. However, this was rejected by the party. This led to De Valera and like-minded colleagues founding a new party by the name of Fianna Fáil. In its first ever election in 1927, Fianna Fáil won 44 seats, just 3 less than Cumann na Gael. Sinn Féin was left decimated, winning only 5. In 1932, just 6 years after its inception, Fianna Fáil won the Irish general election and entered into government, with 72 seats to Cumann na Gael's 57. As a result of their lackluster performances in elections, Cumann na Gael merged with 2 other organisations in 1933. The National Centre Party, which represented farmers, and the National Guard, also known as the Blue Shirts. The National Guard were not a political party, but a group of former pro-treaty IRA men, who provided security at Cumann na Gael meetings, which would often be interrupted by anti-treaty IRA. The merger created Fine Gael, and Eoin O'Duffy, the leader of the Blue Shirts, was put in charge as the new party wanted to appear different to Cumann na Gael. This created problems for Fine Gael, as Eoin O'Duffy was a fascist, and his rhetoric ostracised the party's base. This led to another poor performance in the 1934 local elections, and O'Duffy was ousted as leader. Fine Gael elected W.T. Cosgrave as leader and returned to the traditional conservatism they had advocated for in Cumann na Gael. However, they never managed to lose the Blue Shirts nickname. The animosity caused by the Civil War divided families and communities for generations. So much so that for decades people tended to just vote for whoever their parents had voted for. This restricted the growth of political parties on left-right lines prevalent in the rest of Europe. 2 broadly similar parties dominated in Ireland since then. One of the 2 Civil War foes have been in government every election since the foundation of the state. The old hatred has begun to fade, and with it the permanent dominance has showed signs of waning. In the most recent election, a left-wing Sinn Féin that was founded in 1970 won the popular vote, beating both Fine Gael and Fianna Fáil. Fine Gael and Fianna Fáil retained power by agreeing to go into government as a coalition, but it is the first time their long dominance has been properly challenged. With the next general election due in 2025 or earlier if the government collapses, what do you think? Will Fine Gael and Fianna Fáil continue to dominate, or will we see a new party as the main government party? Let me know what you think in the comments down below.